Hello students, hope you understood the very short answer questions. Those are very, very important questions as far as IP examination is concerned. Concentrate well if you want to score 10%, 60 out of 60. 2 marks question will play crucial role. We'll discuss only important questions from chapters wise weightage as per IP weightage is concerned. So as we were discussing in ray optics, the questions are related to the refraction and total internal reflection. Critical angle, all those things are very, very important. As we were discussing in the previous class, hope you understood. So, mass density is a density per unit, that is a mass per unit volume. It's called mass density, density per unit volume. So, I'll write it again. Mass density is mass per unit volume. You are quite familiar. So, it's units in SI system, kg by meter cube, cubic meter, right? This is mass per unit volume, mass density. Then what is optical density? Optical density means here the ratio of speeds of light to different media. So it is measured in terms of refractive index, velocity of light. So then velocity of light in a medium, right? This is optical density. That's the ratio of the speeds of light in two different media. So this has no units, right? Whereas optical density has no. Whereas mass density certainly has units. The units are kg per meter cube, kg per cubic meter. Then what are the loss of reflection through curved mirrors? Loss of reflection. So what are the loss of reflection? Okay, it holds good to all the reflections. May not be pertaining to the mirrors or curved surfaces. So here imagine the ray travels and then a different mirror gets reflected. Here the angle of incidence, then angle of reflection. So here both are same. So the loss of reflection primary law. So the incident angle, the angle of reflection, both are equal to each other. And then so the incident ray, this is incident ray, reflected ray, and then the normal drawn at the point of incidence. So, if a normal drawn at the point of incidence, all three of them will lie the same plane. The incident ray, reflected ray, and the normal drawn at the point of incidence lie the same plane. This is one of the important laws. So, angle of incidence is equal to angle of the reflection, then incident ray, reflected ray, and the normal drawn to the surface at the point of incidence, right, lie on the same plane. Please make note of it. Next, define the power. This is again one of the important questions. Define the power. So, note down, define the power of convex lens. Convex lens. Define the power of convex lens. What is its units? What is its units? Now, before we define or discuss the power of a convex lens, just observe this diagram. Suppose you have a lens, then the ray incident on the surface of the lens, it gets refraction will take place and converges at a particular point. This is the principal focus. So now see here, this ray, if a lens is not available, it would have traveled straight line path. It gets converged through some angle, let's say delta, or small angle, let's say delta or d or something. This angle is also delta. Let us say this ray is incident at a height h from the principal axis, isn't it? So this distance is of course focal length, the distance between principal focus and optical center. Yeah. So this triangle, if you consider here, tan phi is this is equal to h, opposite side by adjacent side. Yeah. To make this h value is unity, one unit, then what happens? This P is defined as tan of angle of convergence, which is equal to 1 by
f.
Try to understand and remember logically. So power of the lens is defined as the tangent of this angle of convergence, or it can be even divergence also, right? Tangent of angle of convergence when a ray is incident at unit distance. This h is made unity at unit distance from the optical center or principal axis. That is called the power of the lens. It's numerically equal to the reciprocal of focal length expressed in meters. If anybody wants, you can put it this way. So power is defined as the reciprocal of the focal length f in meters, or you can write it this way. This, if you express in centimeters, so this 100 comes here, right? The reciprocal of focal length expressed in meters. So it's numerically equal to the power. The better refined and then polished definition is the power of a lens is defined as the tangent of the angle through which the convergence or divergence takes place. Okay, when a ray of light incident at unit distance from the optical center. So it is numerically equal to the power is numerically equal to the reciprocal of focal length expressed in meters. So obviously units, SI units, make a note of it, it is meter inverse, or it is also called diopter. D, it is denoted by D, diopter D. The power of the lens is so meter inverse or diopters, right? So this is a reciprocal of the focal length expressed in meters, right? So better definition is, it is the power is defined as the tangent of the angle of convergence, either convergence or divergence, right? So when a ray of light incident at unit distance from the optical center. So this very simple and very, very easy definition. Make a note of it. The power of a lens is also defined as the reciprocal of the focal length expressed in meters. Its units are diopters. So note down, students, the power of a lens defined as the reciprocal of focal length expressed in meters. Simpler definition, its SI units are diopters or meter inverse. Meter inverse is also called here diopter. It is also defined like this. The power of a lens is defined as the tangent of the angle of convergence when the ray of light incident at unit distance from the optical center. Next, this small problem related to refractive index. First, let me introduce what is the refractive index and all those things. Snell's law, when a ray is traveling from one medium to another medium, as we already discussed, it bends and travels, isn't it? So angle of incidence, angle of refraction, right? For a given pair of media, for a particular color, we have to define refractive index. Define for a given pair of media, for a particular wavelength, particular color, the ratio of sine of the angle of incidence to sine of the angle of refraction is called the refractive index for that particular given pair of media, that particular color. It remains a constant called refractive index, right? It's also called Snell's law. So whenever ray travels from one medium to another medium, the ratio sine of the angle of incidence to the sine of the angle of refraction remains constant for a given pair of media for a particular color. It's called refractive index. It has no units because the ratio of similar quantity, it has no units. You have an experiment to determine the refractive index of material of the prism. So hope you remember this formula. You might have derived optics, sine of A plus dm by 2. Dm is angle of minimum deviation by sine a by 2. Here a is the angle of the prism, it's the equilateral prism cross section 60 degrees. Dm value is obtained experimentally from ID curve, isn't it? No. Get back to the small problem related to that. Note down, please make a note of it. Write down, I'll read slowly. A small angled prism of 4 degrees, small angled prism of 4 degrees deviates a ray through 2.48 degrees. A small angled prism of 4 degrees deviates a ray through 2.48 degrees. Find the refractive index of the prism. So, very simple problem. So, based on this formula for small angled prism. So, what happens here? Just look at the board here. So, here. So, angle of the prism is given, small angled prism. So, small angled prism of 4 degrees. That means, angle of the prism, A is given to us 4 degrees. Then, angle of deviation is given to us 2.48. Find the refractive index of the prism. So, when A is very, very small, you are familiar, when theta is small, okay, sin theta and tan theta tends to be equal to theta, isn't it? When theta is very, very small, theta is very small, sin theta is nearly equal to theta, isn't it? Now, so applying that, so mu is equal to A plus Dm by 2 by A by 2. So, for small angle prisms, sin theta is equal to theta, applying that, so 2 gets cancelled. Cross multiply, mu A is equal to A plus Dm, or send it that side, Dm is equal to mu A minus A, or you can take A common, it is mu minus 1. Or directly, if you want, you can substitute in the formula and simplify, doesn't matter, you will get the final desired answer. So, this formula, if you are sure, the small angled prism, sin theta is equal to theta, apply that, 2 gets cancelled, you have this formula, directly you substitute A value and Dm value and simplify, right? So, here Dm value is given to us, it's a 2.48, A value is given to us 4 degrees, we want mu value, you send it that side, so mu minus 1, 2.48 divided by 4. Right, so you send this minus 1 that side, therefore refractive index is 2.48 divided by 4 plus 1. Simplify further, you will get desired, is taking LCM and simplifying. So this is 2.48 plus 4. Mathematics, you can adopt any technique, 6.48 divided by 4. You can cancel 2 2s 2 3s. So 3.24 divided by this, nothing but 1.62. Please note down directly, if anybody wants, you can substitute the data here and simplify, you will get the answer. So either way, for mathematics, you can adopt any technique. For small angled prism, A value is given to us, angle of deviation, minimum deviation is given, refractive index. Use this formula for small angle prisms. The formula so takes this shape. So sin theta is equal to theta using this. So 2 gets cancelled. Simplify further, substitute and simplify. Therefore, refractive index is 1.62, has no units. Simply number. Please note down, students. Written. So, I'll repeat, a small angled prism of 4 degrees deviates a ray through 2.48 degrees. Find the refractive index of the prism. Right, this is the basic formula for small angled prisms. So, theta is very, very small. When theta is very well, sine theta is equal to theta as well as tan theta also. So here a plus dm, this 2 gets cancelled. From further simplification substitution, get that expression. Please note down next question. What is dispersion? Which color gets relatively more dispersed? What is dispersion? Which color relatively more dispersed? Which color gets relatively more dispersed? So as you know, dispersion, the process of splitting composite light, white light into its constituent colors. The process of splitting composite light, white light will consist Wibbsian colors. When it is allowed to pass through a prism, right, it will split up into its constant colors. The process of splitting composite light or white light into its constituent colors is called dispersion. The phenomenon or the process of splitting white light into its constituent colors is called dispersion. Please note down here, suppose this is a prism through which a narrow beam, let's say white light, composite light, then different colors are deviated to different extents, splits up, so finally it emerges, and then an array of colors you observe will consist violet at the bottom, red at the top, right? So when a white light though is allowed to pass through the prism, it will split up into its constituent colors. Phenomenon is called dispersion. The process of splitting, the phenomenon of splitting composite light or white light into its constituent colors is called dispersion. Now you just see, if the prism is not present, the ray would have traveled straight line path like this, a straight line path. So the rays gets deviated like this, extend it like this. So here, so this is for deviation for violet, this for deviation for red color. Just by the diagram, you can make out clearly which color is relatively more dispersed. Here at the bottom we have violet color. So violet is relatively more dispersed when compared to other colors. The least dispersed is red color at the top. Red is least dispersed, least deviated. Then violet is, so here maximum dispersed. Written? I repeat this question. What is important? One of the important questions. What is dispersion? The process of splitting white light into its constituent colors is called dispersion. The process of splitting the array of colors observed on the screen called spectrum. Spectrum will classify pure spectrum, impure spectrum. Then rainbow is one of the examples for impure spectrum. We observe phenomenon, natural phenomenon. So during rainy season, especially rainy season. So an array of beautiful array of colors in nature, that is a rainbow, isn't it? This, in fact, it is impure. Colors will be overlapping with each other. Okay, here the colors will get deviated. So here violet get more dispersed, more deviated when compared to other colors. So this is about the ray optics. So students will take up one more chapter. So that's where only we'll be focusing only on very short answer questions as far as IP examination is concerned, weight, chapter wise weightage is concerned. So moving charges and magnetism, so another chapter has 2 marks weightage. We'll just look into that and concentrate and discuss, right? What is the importance? So we'll switch over to next chapter, the chapter number 7, moving charges and magnetism. Moving charges and magnetism. This is chapter 7. Moving charges. Moving charges and magnetism. So hope you remember the topics. So whenever current passes through a conductor, metal wire, then the magnetic field is developed around it. you are familiar, there we studied the magnetic field is developed around it. So obviously, we can find out the intensity of magnetic induction field developed around a current carrying conductor. We discussed, we might have discussed different laws, the Ampere's law, Biot-Savart's law, and the various applications of these two laws, isn't it? Okay, we are not going to discuss all the details now, only very short answer questions. First of all, before that, all current carrying wires, suppose this is a wire carrying certain amount of current, then around this, the magnetic field is developed around it. The current carrying wire behaves like a magnet, magnetic field is developed around it. You can confirm it, you can check it with the help of small compass needle. You take it close, very close to this current carrying conductor, vicinity means very close without touching. Then the compass needle gets deviated, right? That will confirms the fact that a current carrying wire behaves like a magnet, a magnetic field is developed around it. Now, coming to the first question, what is the importance of Eierstedt experiment? Please note down, dear students, chapter number 7 for 2 marks questions, very short answer questions. What is the importance, significance or importance of Eierstedt experiment? Importance of Eierstedt experiment. Importance of Eierstedt experiment. OERSTED, Eierstedt experiment. Scientist's name. So, all the current carrying wires, conductors, so behave like magnets, magnetic field is developed around them. So, around it, singular. So, magnetic field is developed around a current carrying conductor, right? This is the significance or importance of Eierstedt experiment. So, a current carrying wire behaves like a magnet and magnetic field is developed around it. This is no doubt. What is the importance of Eierstedt experiment? A current carrying conductor behaves like a magnet and magnetic field is developed. Magnetic field is developed around it. Next, this is the most important question. How many derivations are there? Ampere's law and Biot-Savart's law, you might have discussed in detail, but here only we'll focus on very short answer questions, 2 marks questions, that state Ampere's law. State Ampere's law and Biot-Savart's law. Note down, state Ampere's law. And Biot and Savart's, apostrophe Savart's law, state Ampere's law and Biot and Savart's law, right? So, as you already studied so in detail, so if we have a wire carrying current, certain amount of current around this, we have magnetic field developed around it. At any point, if you want to know magnetic induction field, so B. So, magnetic induction field at any point, that is determined by Ampere's law due to straight long current carrying conductor or wire. According to Biot and Savart's law, states that so the line integral magnetic induction field along the closed path, so just make a note of it, the statement, according to Ampere's law, the line integral of magnetic induction field around a closed path always equal to mu 0 times the net current enclosed by the surface. This is one of the important statements, numerous, many applications are there, isn't it, Ampere's law. So, make a note of it, state Ampere's law and Biot and Savart's law. I'll go as slowly as possible, make a note of it, state Ampere's law and Biot and Savart's law. Statement, Ampere's law states that the line integral, you see here, this integral symbol, curved, closed path, along the closed path. The line integral of magnetic induction field along the closed path is equal to mu 0 times the net current enclosed by the surface. This is very simple statement, support with the mathematical equation. Integral B bar dl bar is mu 0 I. Here mu 0 is permeability. Make a note of it, permeability of free space or vacuum. The I, of course, the current, strength of current enclosed by the closed surface. This is a very simple statement. Repeat it again. State Ampere's law. Ampere's law statement. The line integral, L-I-N-E, line integral of magnetic induction field along a closed path is equal to mu 0 times the net or resultant or net current enclosed by the closed surface. Write down this expression, support with mathematical equation and explain the terms. Here mu 0 is permeability, I is the net current. Net current enclosed by the closed surface. So write in the B, magnetic induction field. Next, Wyatt and Seward's law. Coming to the second law, we have many applications are there. So magnetic induction field, so due to a current carrying circular coil at the center, axial line, at any point on axial line, and then using that we derived equation for magnetic moment. Okay, all these are very very important derivations are based on it. Wyatt and Seward's law. It's a curved, conductor in a zigzag path, a bent manner, not in straight line path. It is divided into small elements. One such element, current carrying element, is DL. Then Wyatt and Seward's law state the magnetic induction field at any point due to a small current carrying conductor. Be careful here. Current element, it is also called current carrying element. Wyatt and Seward's law states that the magnetic induction field at any point due to a small current carrying element. This point is important, underline. A small current carrying element is always directly proportional to strength of current, the magnetic induction field. The dB is the magnetic induction field due to small current carrying element. This conductor is divided into small elements. One such element will consider having length dl, right? Now carrying certain amount of current I. Now at any point, not only this point, P is a point at a distance r, radius vector r, or the distance from point P from the element is r, the radius vector, it makes an angle, let us say phi. Then magnetic induction field at any point due to a small current carrying element is directly proportional to the strength of the current and also the length of the current carrying element, the DL, and sine of the angle between DL and R, where R is the radius vector, so DL is the current direction. So phi is the angle between DL and R, or R and DL, and inversely proportional to square of the distance of the point from the current carrying element. All of them clubbing together, the magnetic induction field due to a small current carrying element is IDL sine phi, inversely proportional square of the distance. Putting them together, combining, will get this expression. So the magnetic induction field due to a small current carrying element, I'll write it this side, is mu 0 by 4 pi. Mu 0 is permeability. This depends on the medium, free space, vacuum. It is a permeability of free space. So I d l sine phi by r square. So magnetic induction field is a vector quantity. If you want, you can express in the vector form, dB bar. Then in such case, so here we'll get r cube in the right hand side. So here I bar cross dl bar divided by r cube in vector form, right? So just I'll repeat, just please make a note of it, Wyatt and Seward's law, keep the heading. This diagram just to explain you, this you already discussed, state and explain Wyatt and Seward's law. It is one of the important questions for 4 marks as well. Ampere's law is also there. So 2 marks. Statement only, the magnetic induction field at any point due to a small current carrying element is always directly proportional to strength of the current, length of the element, current carrying element, and sine of the angle between R and DL, and inversely proportional to the square of the distance from the point to the current element. So it's very, very simple. Mathematically, we can put it this way. Write this expression and explain the terms. Mu 0 is permeability, I is the strength of the current, DL is the length of current carrying element, and then R is the distance of the point P from the element DL. Of course, phi, the angle between R and DL. Very, very simple, but applications are numerous. Many derivations are based on it. So I'll repeat this: Ampere's law, Biot and Savart's law. Ampere's law said that the magnetic line integral of magnetic induction field, I repeat this, line integral of magnetic induction field along a closed path is equal to mu 0 times the net current enclosed by the closed surface. That is Ampere's law. Whereas Biot and Savart's law, so the magnetic induction due to one such small current carrying element, it is divided into many small elements, one such element. If you want total magnetic induction due to the entire element current carrying wire, so let us say we have to integrate this total magnetic induction. Want integrate, right? This is about Biot and Savart's law. Hope you understood. It's a simple statement. The magnetic induction field at any point due to a small current carrying element directly proportional to strength of the current, length of the element, sine of the angle between this R and DL, and inversely proportional to square of the distance of the point from the element.